Colonel Naidu is a civil engineer, management and security professional with 45 years of experience in the field of combat engineering, chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear and explosive, which is the CBRNE, defense, security and disaster management. He is a former member of International Civil Service while working as a chief weapons inspector, chief chemical weapons inspector for nearly a decade with the OPCW in Canada. Also won the Nobel Peace Presentation and Knowledge Center. He is also a prolific writer and speaker and has participated in various international and domestic conferences on CBR and security, disaster management, and counter-explosive issues. He also writes articles for many CBRNE and CIED-related journals worldwide. I would now request Colonel Naidu to take over the mic and grace us with his knowledge and words. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanchita. Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As part of our episode 2 of India Security series, I'm going to talk to you on threats arising out of chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear materials, and how and why India is vulnerable to these threats. Before we go any further, I would like to draw your attention or reiterate there's a problem with the slide. Okay, sorry about it. So the objectives of the India Security Series is, as mentioned earlier by Sanchita, is to bring in awareness to general public on various security issues faced by India. The presentations therefore are very basic and simple and do not contain much of technical details. And those of you who are security professionals attending the seminar, this could be a refresher or probably an add-on knowledge. Now, today's topic of CBR and threats and vulnerabilities does not or relates to only non-military and non-war scenarios. We have advisories which hold biological and nuclear weapons, but we are not discussing that scenario. It's basically, we are talking about threats from non-state players, terrorists, militants, insurgents, and other anti-national elements. Now, today's presentation will cover what are CBRN materials. We are not discussing CBRN weapons because materials could be delivered to the target even without weaponization. That's why we'll cover CBRN materials. We'll also see how these CBRN materials are delivered to the target and go through various incidents in last 40 years, which will guide us or probably take us towards a possible threat from CBRN materials. And then we'll actually talk about the CBRN threats and the vulnerabilities from these threats. Now, coming to CBRN material, chemicals, we have the chemical warfare agents. Now, it is pertinent to mention here that under the Chemical Weapons Convention signed by 193 countries, 99% of chemical weapons stockpile has been destroyed. However, there is a provision in the convention for countries to retain those toxic chemicals which are of dual use, that is, which could be used for weaponization and which can also use for peaceful purposes. So though these facilities are regulated, but there is always a chance of leakage of this material from these facilities. Now, coming to the various chemical warfare agents, we have the nerve agents, which attacks the victim's nervous system. It inhibits the communications from the brain to various organs through the nervous system. And amongst the nerve agents, we have sarin, tabun, somon, and VX. They are very powerful chemical warfare agents. And we also have a new entry into these nerve agents called Novichok. If some of you recollect, in March 2018, the famous Salisbury poisoning case, where a Russian dissident spy was poisoned with Novichok, which is a new chemical that was in Salisbury in UK. So novichok is now also included in one of the banned chemicals under the nerve agents. Now we have the blister agents, which attack the skin of the victim, resulting in blisters and skin burns. It's not only external blisters, but even within the body, mucous membranes, they are all affected by blister agents. The blister agents, we have sulfur mustards, nitrogen mustard, and leucocyte. Then we have the blood agents, which attack the blood, which attack the ability of blood to hold and deliver oxygen. Now the victim therefore suffocates with attack by blood agents, which are some of these blood agents are hydrogen cyanide and cyanogen chloride. Now we have what's called pulmonary agents or a choking agent, which attack the lungs, causing them to fill with fluid. Phosgene, chlorine, and chloropicrin are some of the choking agents. Then we have the incapacitating agent, which usually irritate the skin, mucous membrane, eyes, nose, and mouth. They are actually used as anti-rheumatic agents also. And it causes vomiting and intolerable pain. And amongst the incapacitating agents, we have the CS and the BZ. Then we have the toxins, which are poisonous substances produced by living organisms like snakes, castor beans, or botulinum toxin, which is produced by the marine life. In addition to these chemical warfare agents, we have toxic industrial and commercial chemicals produced and transported and stored all over India, especially in the western states of Gujarat, Maharashtra, southern states of or those facilities like the fertilizer plants, petrochemical plants, pesticide plants, plastics, textile manufacturing. These are all common toxic industrial and commercial chemicals, which are available in the market for anti-nutritional elements. Now coming to the biological agents, we have pathogens which cause diseases and they reproduce and keep spreading long after the actual biological attack. Amongst the pathogens, we have the bacteria, the most popular being the anthrax, and we have the plague, we remember Surat in 1996, and we have cholera and diphtheria. On the viruses side, we have the smallpox, we have Ebola, we have COVID-19, which is prevalent presently, we have swine flu, and the dengue. These all come under the viruses. And we have the rickettsia, the G fever, and typhus. And also comes under biological material is the toxins. Toxins come both under chemical and also biological agents. These are poisonous substances, like I mentioned earlier, produced by the living things. So most popular being the botulism toxin, ricin, and aflatoxin. Then we have agri-bio threat agents, which are the foot and mouth disease, avian flu, that is the bird flu, mad cow diseases, monkey malaria, and certain agricultural diseases like the bean rust and the kernel burn. In addition to these, there is also synthesized biological agents, genetically manipulated in laboratories, but it requires a lot of expertise and access to high technology. Next, we come to radiological material. More than 144 radioisotopes, about 15-20 of them are very high energy, which are alpha emitters, beta emitters, and very powerful gamma emitters. In alpha emitters, we have the plutonium, we have the americium and radium. In the beta emitters, we have the strontium, phosphorus, and the gamma emitters, we have the cobalt-60, cesium, and iridium. Now, all these radiological materials are extensively used in the industry, oil industries, steel industry. They are used in research laboratories. They are used for medical diagnostics and even used for space. For example, the radioisotope thermoelectric generators are used to power spaceships. So these are essentially used. And in India, there are more than 7,000 institutions, research or medical facilities, which have instruments which contain the radiological material. In addition to these institutes, thousands of industries which use, for example, the oil industry for well logging, and we have the industrial gauges, we have the instrument illuminations, and other industrial applications. So these are available, but luckily these last 10 years, they have come under effective regulation by the Atomic Energy Regulation Body. I'm not covering the nuclear material because we all know nuclear fuels, you know, enriched uranium or plutonium, which are scarce or not easily available. But suffice to say, there were attempts to steal these materials from some of the facilities in India. As we go by in the presentation, I'll be able to cover these in that. Now, what are the delivery methods for toxic chemicals? The ventilation systems of buildings, you know, huge buildings, commercial complexes, or for example, housing complexes, multi-story, they have centralized heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. So introduction of chemical, toxic chemicals into ventilation systems would cause many deaths. So ventilation systems is one of the source methods of delivery. Then you have the misting, aerosolizing devices, and sprayers. And there's also passive release, where containers having toxic chemicals are left open in areas where highly populated, say for example, the shopping malls or cinema halls. These keep emitting vapors, chemical vapors. Then we have the bombs, mines, and other explosive devices that contain chemicals other than those used to create the explosion. So we need an explosive. Plus, in addition, we have those toxic chemicals which are delivered. Then we have improvised chemical devices which combine two or three innocuous looking chemicals to produce one dangerous chemicals, what we call the binary weapons. Then we have sabotage of plants and vehicles containing chemicals. And then radiation. Then also the chances of, you know, sabotaging of plants and vehicles containing chemicals, and introduction of toxins in food and water supply. So these are various methods for delivery of or dissemination of toxic chemicals. Then coming to the biological agents, these are disseminated either as liquids or solids, more in the form of powders, either through aerosol dissemination, contaminating food and water, human carriers. You have seen in biological COVID, you know, contagious diseases, plague, contagious diseases. So human carriers are also used. Then we have infected animals, mad cow, bird flu, monkey malaria. These are all infected animals which spread the biological things. Then physically distributed through mail and other means. You must have read in these papers a couple of years back, I think 10 to 12 years back, we have the US mail services delivering mail to various public figures and senators, mail laced with anthrax. So this is one means of delivering the biological agents. And we have the agricultural attack and livestock with a point introduction of an infected plant and its fluids among the crops. Now, coming to the radiological materials, we also call radiological weapons as weapons of mass disruption. Instead of mass destruction, we call them as weapons of mass disruption. Now, radiological dispersal devices, you see here in the first photograph, it's an RDT. I'll show you in an enlarged version subsequently. This is a dirty bomb, which uses conventional explosives to disperse radioactive material over the targeted area. Then we have radiological emission devices, very quietly placed in a container and in a public places, and which keeps emitting radiations. And we have radiological incendiary devices that couple fire with radiological material for greater dispersion. Then these radiological materials could also be delivered aerially by drones, UAVs, aircraft, which basically disperse powdered or aerosolized forms of radioactive material. Then radiation poisoning, contamination of food, beverages, and water supply systems. Now, this is an enlarged version of a so-called dirty bomb. It's not a nuclear weapon, please. So some people mistake it as a nuclear weapon. You see here, the inner core is an explosive element. You have surrounded by the pencils of radiation material, like the cobalt pencils. Then you have the detonator, the power source, and this was one of those similar designs used by somebody who was trying to accuse for plotting to build and detonate a bomb in the United States way back in year 2006. Now, radiation exposure, how does it affect on human body? Now, before we go for that, we need to understand what is contamination and what is exposure. Exposure is that you're exposed to radiation energy. You take a dose of radiation energy, a number of grays or centigrays, radiation energy, you're exposed to it, then that's called exposure. But you have the radiation material inside your body or outside your body through inhalation or ingestion, or even the radiation dust falling on your body, you're contaminated. So you're both contaminated and exposed. But a person who is exposed only is not contaminated. So that's the difference. A person who is exposed, for example, depending what are the effects on eyes, thyroid, lungs, stomach, reproductive organs, skin, and bone marrow. It all depends on the dose. The moderate risk, if the dose is something what is shown on the slide, the moderate risk is the tolerable levels, and the high risk where the doses are very high, something up to 10,000 microsieverts. Now, after we have seen what are the CBR and material and how are they delivered, we need to go and try and see, let's see various CBR and incidents in India for the last 40 years. And the most important, as all most of us recollect, is the Bhopal gas tragedy of 3rd December 1984, which resulted in roughly about 15,283 deaths. Now, I'll take little time and explain this, what happened on that fateful night of 3rd December 1984. On this slide, now, you have three of these tanks here. This tank number 610, 611, and 619. And one of them is empty. The one which is 610 has got 40 tons. And unfortunately, there was a leakage of water into this tank, and which causes a runaway heat producing reaction. So it gets heated up. So methyl isocyanate, very hot. And we have four safety mechanisms which are supposed to be functional. But unfortunately, on that fateful day, none of these were functional. The first being the refrigeration system, which was for saving costs, was removed. The Freon system was removed. The cooling liquid was removed and moved to another plant location. Therefore, there was no refrigeration. There was no cooling. Therefore, hot methyl isocyanate was going out to what is called the vent gas scrubber. Now, this is the second mechanism. And the vent gas scrubber, which detoxifies the toxic gases through detoxification through what is called the sodium hydroxide. Now, unfortunately, on that day, whether it was an accident or a safety lapse or by design, even that scrubber was turned off. The third safety mechanism, after the gases come out of the vent gas scrubber, if any remnants go to what's called the flare tower, which is designed to burn gases. But on that fateful day, again, a pipe connecting this flare tower was removed for maintenance. So three safety mechanisms failed. Now comes the fourth, that is the water curtain. Now, water curtain was set for releasing water to a height of only 12 to 15 meters, whereas gas was leaking from the vent scrubber at the height of 30 meters and high. So obviously the gas could not be curtailed. It spread and it resulted in about 15,000 deaths and half a million incapacitated, some of them for life. Now, there was many other incidents. For example, there was a tube leak in Tarapur in 1992. A recovery of uranium-235 is a weapon-grade material from criminals in Tamil Nadu in 1998. Then we have another theft of natural uranium from the Indira Gandhi Atomic Research Center in Kalpakkam. Then 26 kg of uranium from illicit traffickers for the nuclear fuel complex at Hyderabad. Then a chemical explosion at the fuel fabrication facilities again at Hyderabad. then a valve failure at Kalpakkam reprocessing plant. Now mind it, these are all reported incidents. There could be many unreported incidents. And then the famous Delhi Mayapur radiation instrument leakage. The story for in this is that the Delhi University, which acquired certain instruments which contained cobalt 60, was way back in 1965, stopped its use in 1985, and then in year 2010 thought it wise to auction it off to a scrap dealer. The scrap dealer bought it, and in curiosity, the scrap dealer opened up the cobalt pencil, cut it into 11 pieces, and one piece he kept it in his wallet, you know, as a souvenir. And two pieces he moved to the shop owned by the, you know, the scrap depot. So there was a lot of radiation contamination spread in the scrap yard with this gentleman and various locations. So it was a big exercise to neutralize the radiation instrument. Then there was 15 disused cobalt isotopes stolen from the Steel Authority of India plant at Durgapur in the year 2011. Now coming nearer here, March 2018, a chemical factory in Palghat, you can see the pictures here, 3 deaths. Then Tarapur chemical blast, 6 deaths. Then you have Vizag latest, Vishakhapatnam, the LG polymers plant, where leakage of styrene gas was 12 deaths. And then we have the Dahej chemical plant explosion, 8 deaths. And we have the Bhagjan oil well fire, 2 deaths. Even yesterday, there was a second fire. And 3 of the foreign technicians, I think, were seriously injured and now are in critically ill. Now, overall, if you see, there were 50 radiological, 36 biological, and 90 chemical reported incidents over the last 40 years in India. And over 80 major chemical accidents in major accident hazard units, you know, they are classified as accident hazard units. So there were such major chemical accidents involving chemicals like chlorine, ammonia, LPG, and hazardous chemicals. Then frequent outbreaks of diseases leading to fears, causes of illness could be intentionally introduced by, it is suspected, these were probably introduced by hostile organization. And we have been seeing for last 6 to 7 years, thousands affected each year with swine flu, dengue, chikungunya, and now this dreaded COVID-19. Now, with all these incidents, one could summarize or conclude, in fact, there is a threat. There is a threat from these materials, especially during peace times, if they are not well regulated, there of, you know, what you call compromise in safety and security mechanisms will lead to these such incidents. And in fact, there is a threat for CBRN threat prevalent in India. Now let's see what are these threats. Now you see these pictures above here. Your biolaboratory, you have transportation of oil, then you have an oil, a chemical industry. Now, these threats, like I mentioned earlier, could be from non-state players, probably supported by a state, or terrorist, insurgents, anti-nationals. Now, attack or sabotage of large number of nuclear facilities which we have, whether it is a fuel processing or fuel storage facilities or nuclear power plants, or research reactors. Then chemical plants, I mentioned earlier, Hyderabad, Coimbatore, Baroda, Mumbai, hundreds and thousands of these chemical plants are there. These could be attacked. And biological laboratories, BS3, BS4 level, safety level laboratories could be attacked or sabotaged through insiders. And various sources of radioactive materials, like I mentioned to you, thousands of facilities, institutions having instruments which are powered by the radioactive materials, and during transportation systems by road, rail, even if you have specialized transportation systems, there could always be an attack or a sabotage of these. And present day, with these drones and UAVs coming, it's making the task of the terrorists easier to attack or sabotage a facility. The second threat is pilferage of these toxic chemicals, radiation materials, nuclear fuels, nuclear waste, and virulent pathogens for use against population. There's always a possibility, and it is there. Very, very strong threat. Then spread of radioactive materials in commercial districts and contaminate facilities or places where people live and work, disrupting lives and livelihoods. It causes great panic and fear. The fear of that you probably are contaminated with radioactive material is, leads to panic and very scary situation. Then release of toxic chemicals in closed spaces like metros, subways, airports, and even financial centers. One could release, we did in fact go through various means of dissemination or delivery of this toxic chemicals. So this is one threat which is there. Then acquire and use of improvised nuclear devices. So some of the security specialists may probably not agree, but you see the picture here. It's a picture downloaded from International Atomic Energy Commission, our agency in Vienna, Geneva. With the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991, it is believed a number of the so-called improvised nuclear devices, or what we call the suitcase bombs, were smuggled out of Soviet Union for financial benefits, either to most of these Muslim countries which are part of the present-day Russian Federation or various other hostile groups. So there is always a possibility, a threat of acquiring and using of improvised nuclear devices. Then we have a threat of contamination of our reservoirs and urban water supply systems with either virulent pathogens or high toxic chemicals. Actually, toxic chemicals are best or most effective by introducing them in the supply chain, not in the reservoirs, because they get diluted. So like you do in water supply, introduction of a liquid chlorine as a disinfectant, even chemical warfare agents could be induced or could be injected in the water supply system. And of course, the virulent pathogens, you see a picture out here. Then contaminate food, beverages, drugs, cosmetics, fluids, stamps, envelopes, both at the manufacturing or in the distribution process, and even at the near point of consumption. We know that we use radiological material for food irradiation. So it could be a dose could be extended, increased, that would cause food poisoning and contamination of food. And releasing of gases or aerosols into buildings or, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems, and also from the aircraft. And three other threats, which probably most of us don't realize, is stealing of CBR and technologies and equipment. We all know how Pakistan has been able to enrich its uranium. They've stolen the designs of the centrifuges from Netherlands and somehow enriched their uranium and got themselves a nuclear weapon. So there's always a possibility, whether even in the chemical processing technology, very highly confidential chemical processing technology, even in the biological laboratories, the technologies or the science involved, these could be stolen. And the design of equipment, which are specifically designed for these purposes, could be also be stolen. And there were many cases. The next threat is kidnap and kill CBR and knowledge assets, human assets, basically, scientists and technologists. We all read in the newspapers how Israel neutralized some of the nuclear scientists from Iran and Iraq. They keep continuously getting after these scientists. And we also read in India, a couple of scientists missing or kidnapped or killed over the last 3 to 4 decades belonging to either the space or the atomic energy or to the DRDO. And the last one is attack. Sorry. Now, after we have seen the threats, let's see why India is and how India is vulnerable. The first thing is lack of public awareness. There is no public outreach programs. Now, presently for the COVID, the last 4 months, there's a lot of awareness which is brought into the public. So the fear and panic which existed sometime in month of March when the cases were very low, and the fear of panic now is much better. We are much placed, better placed in spite of very huge numbers of infections. So awareness or education of public really helps. And unfortunately, for various reasons, there is a lack of public awareness. Therefore, fear of the unknown. So it leads to panic. Anything you are not knowing, we are now well versed with the effects of corona, what precautions to take, what measures to take. So there's not much fear or panic. But if there is no awareness, then there will be fear of the unknown. Very huge population, high density and floating populations. Now cities like Mumbai, Kolkata, Delhi, 11 million, 12 million people in one city and very high density population. So which makes huge targets, you know, either for radiological weapons, for the biological weapons, or even for say a chemical weapon. So high density, huge target and huge floating populations. Bombay, in a single day, about 1 million people get in and get out of Bombay in a normal circumstances, not under the COVID situations. So they transmit radiological contamination. They transmit biological diseases. So we are highly populated with high density population and huge floating population of urban centers are vulnerable to CBRN material and use of CBRN materials. Next, why we are vulnerable is a very poor health, hygiene, and sanitation countries, both in urban areas and rural areas. Thanks to Swachh Bharat, that's probably improved a bit. But see this picture here, the holy river of Ganga. Only people blinded by faith could take bath in this river. I wouldn't take bath in such rivers. So obviously, it will spread diseases, such very unhygienic, bad sanitation. And see here the slums. Now we have been reading in newspapers, the slum in Dharavi, the infection spread like anything. You know, it helps in spreading. So India, known for it because of its poverty or because of public awareness, we have very poor health, hygiene, and sanitation conditions, which makes us very vulnerable to CBRN threats. Inadequate infrastructure. So there's been improvement in last a decade or so, some good infrastructure coming. You see this picture here, a 4-lane road converted into a 10-lane traffic lane. You see there are 10 lanes of traffic trying to get through this 4-lane traffic. So we lack civic sense. Let's all face the fact that we are very low in civic sense. Now, how do you expect the first responders, whether it is the medical rescue teams or the fire services, how can they reach to the incident site with such bad infrastructure or bad civic sense? Now, see here, one pole holding more than 100 cables, laughable. And poor fireman who comes with his ladder to go up and try to douse the fire, how can he reach to the building with such type of infrastructure? So we are inadequate, very bad infrastructure. So again, vulnerable. And we're very casual, casual for death. We both as people or governments, we are very casual of safety and security. You see the picture here, people sitting on the trains, on the top, they're not bothered. And in India, unfortunately, human lives not matter much. 10 deaths there, 100 people dying here. It's a routine. And it really doesn't attention, nobody bothers for it. And government is not proactive. It's always reacting. You see so many accidents take place on the Bombay-Pune expressway, but it's always, actions of the government are reactive. They're not proactive. So with this casual attitude and knowledge, attitude towards safety and security, so vulnerability increases. Then we have the non-compliance to laws and ineffective, corrupt and regulatory bodies. India is a beautiful country with fantastic laws, but we have very few people who abide by these laws. Unfortunate thing. We have fantastic laws, hundreds of them, but nobody abides by them. You see here, the chemical industry polluting our water bodies, land being polluted by various, these are all the, culprits. Whether it is the plastic factories, chemical plants, oil refineries, nuclear waste disposal activity. And then we have regulatory bodies. And these regulatory bodies of late increase in numbers. And either they're ineffective or they're corrupt. So with lax regulation, with non-compliance in the field of especially bio or chemical areas, environmental protection laws are not respected. Pollution control boards are defunct, I would say. So therefore, we are vulnerable. Inadequate disaster and first responder mechanisms. We do have about 12 battalions for national disaster response. That is peanuts, I would say. A huge country like India and a large population, these are inadequate resources. Our first responders, not fully trained, well-trained in all aspects of disasters, and more so on the CBR and disasters. The 12 battalions of the NDRF, only 4 or 5 battalions have specialists or training to cater for CBR and incidents or disasters. So lack of resources or inadequate resources, it's not only to do with disaster, it's also on the medical field. It is also on the civil defense side. You know, we don't effectively utilize our civil defense mechanisms or home guard mechanisms. You know, we don't utilize them. So inadequate disaster and first responder mechanisms could be one reason why we are vulnerable. Then most important, very slow criminal convictions. Agonizing, Indian criminal justice system is very agonizing. It takes 20 to 30 years, even a guy who is openly murdered to be convicted. He's there for 20 years as an under trial, but the trial doesn't take place and he's not convicted. I'll give you an example of the Bhopal gas tragedy. The tragedy occurred in 1984. And yet 2010, exactly 26 years after, 6 of the executives of the Union Carbide plant are now what is called the Dow Chemicals were convicted. So it took 26 years to convict those criminals who were responsible for death of 15,000 innocent people and roughly about 500,000 people injured. So painful it is, Indian criminal justice system. The fault lies not only with the judiciary, it lies with the so-called the advocates and the pleaders. It lies with the people. We find loopholes in our system and try and delay what we call the justice. So obviously, why should anybody care about getting convicted? I can do anything, or one could do anything he likes and still get away with money or manipulations of the legal systems or the criminal justice systems. So these are the 8 reasons when I say why we are vulnerable. And there could be many. I just, because of shortage of time, I just limited myself to these 8 factors which makes us immensely vulnerable to CBRN threats. Now, what are these areas where we could face these threats? Large events, we have political rallies. Each of the political parties claiming 2 lakh turnover or 1 million turnover. They're not realizing their potential targets for this CBR. Then we have the critical infrastructure, which could be affected. Imagine a radiation source or a chemical source in the Banihal tunnel, Jawhar tunnel at Banihal. That would cause a lot of panic and problems for us. And huge sporting events, Motera Stadium, Ahmedabad, Prime Minister was very proud to host President Trump. 110,000 people sitting there, sitting ducks, vulnerable targets. Then we have the soft targets, people carrying, either radiological or chemical agents into the aircraft. Though we have, at least in the Western countries, they have detectors to detect any such hostile material. But there are always possibilities. Some of the airports in India, which I have seen, which are not manned by the CASF, but which are manned by the local police. And there is always a chance of these hostile elements, smuggling in or bringing in these material into the soft targets. Then we have the VIPs, then commercial districts, the industrial complexes, the metro stations, and nuclear power plants. There are many. Many of targets. I'm not really going into all of them. I just listed some of these so that gives you an idea. The places where these threats could materialize. Now, this brings me to end of my presentation. We going to meet next week for episode 3, not next week, next fortnight on 6th of August to talk about improvised explosive devices, which are weapons of choice for terrorists. So I am now open for any questions from the participants.
Thank you, sir. So this was very insightful. And there are lots of questions. There are lots of queries around it. So I'll begin with the questions. The first question is, from the Bhopal gas tragedy experience, are any system modifications mandated to obviate such multiple mistakes?
Yes, Bhopal taught us a big lesson. We have what is called the National Chemical Policy, which which sets up what's called a National Chemical Center, which regulates the safety and security of these chemical plants. But unfortunately, the so-called National Chemical Policy, which was evolved in 2009, was not published or not formally approved even as of today. And I happened to have a friend who was secretary in the Ministry of Chemicals and Petrochemicals. So I always keep nagging him, advise that after 11 years, we haven't come out with what's called a national chemical policy, which gives out the standard operating procedures related to the safety and security of chemical plants all over India. And in addition to that, we have voluntary work done by the Indian Chemical Council, which runs a lot of training courses for its staff, for its engineers, talking about the safety needed in chemical process industries. I would say there is a great improvement, but then the incidents of this month, 4 chemical incidents, Vizag, Palghar, at Dahej, doesn't show that we really making any headway as far as chemical safety and security is concerned. Does it answer the question?
Yeah, I got one point here. This regarding our present scenario. And we are not able to meet the requirements from the past history. You have rightly brought out the complete history meticulously, but what government is taking actions from the history, and what are the steps that are being taken by the government? And also the other thing, as you rightly brought out, the public should be aware. And I'm sure even after such a history and also the second point I want to bring it to your knowledge is, are we capable of meeting China in the present scenario, especially in the Siachen Glacier and other high altitude areas? What is our future if at all the balloon breaks?
Colonel Raju, firstly, your second question, it doesn't pertain to this presentation. So I will avoid answering that question. Regarding your first question, which you are mentioning, see, India has always been famous for what's called the knee-jerk reactions. And we forget things very fast. Bhopal happened, a lot of talk. And I was very much, in fact, I was member of a board of which was constituted to raise an institute for chemical safety and security at Baroda. And we made a huge project report. And unfortunately, the lady who was dealing the project, she doesn't know the difference between safety and security. You understand? So safety is different from security. So that is the type of, this we have. Unfortunately, we only talk much, that there's nothing much happening. But I wouldn't say there's nothing happening. Nothing much happening. And there's great scope to really, get up, especially, and like you said, there's no awareness. As far as people are aware of floods, cyclones, earthquakes, fire, but nobody's aware of CBRN. Of late, only thanks to COVID, we are aware of what is called the biological diseases. But otherwise, once people are well educated through a very, extensive public outreach program, I'm sure people will be ready to face such any threats coming, and will be supportive of any measures which the government takes. I hope I've answered your question.
Yeah, it's true, but the thing is, how are we going to counter China and Pakistan? Are we capable of countering them in case something happens, especially in the LAC and also in the deep into the main metros, if something happens?
Colonel Raju, probably you missed out my introductory slide. I said the aim of objective of this slide, of this presentation is for firstly awareness in general public. And I did very clearly mention we are discussing a non-war scenario or a non-military scenario.
Okay,
so
it is
not in the purview of, you know, of today's presentation.
Okay,
we can just talk about it separately. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, you brought out a complete history and it was a meticulous presentation. I think some more session to the public should be organized.
Yeah, let's have more
thank
questions,
so
Sanchita.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir. There are lots of questions.
Okay.
I think it is rightly said that these are the topics that we ignore. But we should know. So around that, there is a question from Dhilonji, which is why this subject, though very important, is often ignored by security agencies in India. If that is not the case, then which are the various agencies besides defense forces and NDRF which can handle such a threat?
Firstly, you know, people are very skeptical about this issue of CBRN. Even when I was serving in the army, and even when I talk to top generals about CBRN, they probably take it for granted and they say, okay. And even in discussions within the army, not much importance is given, though there's a great change in last 10 years in at least attitude towards the so-called CBRN specialist. Similarly, it goes, you know, thanks to, I think last 10, 12 years, there's a great capacity building in our central paramilitary forces. Then we have the state disaster management authorities, or at the district level, we have this district, you know, disaster management authorities, which are now, I would say last 5 years, seriously thinking about and also gearing up to deal with this CBRN threats. In addition to the NDRF, the SDRF, that is State Disaster Response Forces, are those police forces which are earmarked to act as SDRFs, are slowly getting trained at various locations in DRC, at DRDO in Gwalior, and at the NIM, an institute in Delhi on various aspects. It is certainly caught the imagination, but not as much as it is deserves to be. This is unfortunate. So generally, there's a problem between the specialists and the generalists. So generalists wouldn't like to encourage specialists talking much. So that not only is it the army, I think it's most government bodies. And I did give you an example of my experience with this lady who's a secretary level officer in the Gujarat government. And she's the CEO of the Gujarat State Disaster Authority. And she won't accept any of my suggestions or proposals which are technically supported technically. So you get disheartened or disappointed. But it's not all that bad. We have made good improvements, good capacity building to handle these chemical incidents or CBRN incidents. But they are very less when compared to the size of the country and the population. Next, any question?
Yes, sir. The next question is from Pramod Gaikwad, which is, sir, do you think CBRN weapons might become a more common in terrorist attacks in future? And are our security and other organizations trained to handle such situations?
Yes, there are great threats from terrorists or militants or whatever you call them, especially, there's a lot of information available on the net. So one could become expert in no time in the sense of going through the net and know what are the sources of these materials and how to make a crude chemical device. That's what people in Afghanistan have done. The terrorists or the militants in Iraq have been doing, in Syria have been doing against the coalition forces. And it's also possible in India. And we have very smart, extremists in the Red Corridor, very, very smart, come out with innovative ideas on explosive devices. And I'm sure they all must be having an idea of how to make a chemical or a radiological device. Probably they're stuck up with problem of getting the resources in terms of chemicals, yes, one could get. But certainly, can you hear me? So there is a possibility, and that's what the aim of my presentation today was, to sensitize people on the threats from the so-called, anti-nationals or non-state players using CBRN material, when I say E, matlab explosives, also for terrorist or such purposes.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The next question is from Rama Thavale, sir, which is, should we institute a basic CBRN risk mitigation curriculum as a capsule at high school and college level?
That probably would be far-fetched. If you want to introduce a whole lot of CBRN, already have some capsules related to disaster, I believe. But within the disaster, there are various types of disasters. So one disaster, one incident could be CBRN. But certainly at the university and college levels, may not be at the school levels, we have universities running the disaster management courses, many universities. So the CBRN disasters or CBR incidents could form part of the curriculum at the college level, at the university level, but certainly not at primary school or the secondary school level, because as it is, they are loaded with so much of knowledge, and the government on one side is trying to reduce their syllabus, and make it more friendly. So at that stage, to introduce CBRN, to my mind, of course, Colonel Pavle himself is an expert in CBRN, so I do respect his views, but my personal view is probably at a college or a university level, these could be introduced. And there could be a lot of outreach programs, general public, in terms of pamphlets or brochures or posters, that would really educate people. And I'm telling you from my experience, what my state in month of March about COVID, both my mental state, fear and panic, and what's my state now, I'm not anymore scared or, this thing about this COVID, because I am now well informed. So that's very important, public outreach and bringing awareness. So what Colonel Atawale says, yes, it could be done, but to me, it could probably be done in colleges and universities when there is a better understanding.
Okay, sir. The next question.
Can I just clarify? Sorry, sir. Thank you for giving that explanation. I'm fully with you. In fact, my question read at high school and college level only, not below that. So I would like to correct that accordingly. Okay. And I fully agree with you that at college level or maybe even postgraduate level, even in medical colleges for that matter, CBRN curriculum can be included. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Kanla Tavale. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. The next question to you is, are there any CBRN penetration tests for high vulnerability targets?
I didn't get your question. Repeat it, please.
It is from Nachiket, which is, are there any CBRN penetration tests for high vulnerability targets?
Now, what is penetration sets?
Tests.
See, certainly, in fact, of course, it's not in the public domain, I should share. There are measures at Ministry of Home Affairs, measures taken the high, value targets, say, for example, a parliament or say the Rashtrapati Bhavan, they're all protected from CBRN. Rest be assured, that they are all protected. And in fact, Colonel Atavale has been the advisor to the Minister of Home Affairs in this context, and maybe many other. In fact, some of you probably may not be knowing, there are various radiation detection devices installed, equipment installed at various locations in, say, Mumbai or Delhi. Like you have the, what they call CCTV cameras. And I'm told there are radiation detection equipment installed at various locations. May not be sufficient enough, but certainly there is a way forward. It's a way forward. And very, you know, very high value targets, the VIP targets are very well protected. That I can tell you with authority. And I'm sure Colonel Atavale will be with me.
Sir, thank you for giving that explanation. And you're very right. A lot of work has been done and is being done. Suffice it to say that these critical establishments, or as mentioned in the question, high vulnerability targets, they are adequately protected as far as CBR is concerned.
Thank you, Ram.
Thank you, sir. There is another question from Colonel Swami.
Actually, my question is, ki, is this when I see in a larger picture, it seems COVID-19 is not a mistake. I think it is a well-planned trial sort of thing, I feel. That's what.
Yeah, you see, there are two versions. One would say the Wuhan laboratory, which was probably experimenting on these COVID-19, either intentionally leaked it, or it could be accidental that one of the scientists, the woman there, who got infected and then she spread that infection to that famous meat or fish market. So there are two schools which say that it was intentionally spread by China, and say, why is that China is not so much affected like other countries? But when it comes to China, we'll have to really be, you know, a little skeptical about. They don't let the news come out of China. You know, there may be thousands of people dying in China. I really can't vouch for whether it was an intentional leakage from this Wuhan. I think it's a BS4 laboratory, biosafety lab grade 4. So maybe it was intentionally leaked, or probably an accident. You know, this lady got infected and then spread this virus into this so-called market there.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Next.
Yes. The next question is, how do you consider the events like Bhopal or the recent ones like Vishakhapatnam as a challenge to the national security?
Yes, it is a challenge. In fact, that's the reason when, in fact, in my last presentation episode, when I covered a perspective on national security, this CBRNE forms an important aspect. Unfortunately, it's not very much realized at the appropriate levels. But in last 10 years, there is a sense of awareness of this threat. And things like Bhopal, luckily, Vizag was a very small leakage. Or, the other one at Dahej in Baroch. But this could be very big accidents. Now imagine a place like Chambur in Mumbai, highly populated with thousands of chemical industries. God forbid if there is an accident in a chemical industry, we're going to lose a lot of people. So there is obviously a great threat. Highly populated like Chambur, known for its chemical industry, and there was in fact some accident in a Bharat Petroleum refinery at Chambur. During my training about 35 years back, I did visit these facilities, some of these industries, and how they bribe their way through with the pollution control board and don't comply with the pollution control rules and laws. It's amazing. So we talk a lot, but unfortunately at the regulation level, regulatory bodies are, like I brought out, not effective, either they're corrupt. And our entire system is rotting, I must say. So there could be another Bhopal, let me tell you. And especially high density population like Mumbai, say for example, Baroda. In fact, Mumbai is a big case, or Coimbatore, for example. So someday we're going to have this problem if you don't wake up.
Okay, sir. There is another question from Shettiji, which is, will involving public affected by chemical leakages improve enforcement of safety laws?
No. Enforcement of safety security has got nothing to do, bring those people affected. As Shopi says, it doesn't make difference. Visuals showing some of this thing. It has to come from within, our system. We are known to break laws. We have fantastic. I don't think any visuals, showing these, victims momentarily, probably short-term memories, and we are very known for short-term memories. I don't think it's going to make a great difference. But if maybe for a few days, you need a sustained effort of public outreach through televisions, through TV, through movies. You see, these days, if you see, go and see a movie, a very nice advertisement which comes against smoking, And it doesn't come before the start of the movie, because if it comes before the start of the movie, half of the people switch off. So just once the movie starts, midway they inject this, advertisement of this friend Akshay Kumar talking about firstly the sanitary pad, one advertisement. Other advertisement is on smoking. So something like that, everybody, the private party should join us. Like the Indian Chemical Council is really doing a lot of voluntary work to avoid such accidents coming. But then there is always shortcuts for, business. Profit is the motive for business, So to make profits, like it happened in Union Carbide plant in Bhopal, four of those safety mechanisms failed that day. So was it an accident? Was it by design or by default? So one has to ponder. So I still feel there's a lot of outreach required, to educate people. And with program, there are nice posters put up in our villages, which really brought in a revolutionary change in the attitude of the people using these toilets. So something like that should happen.
Yeah, may I intervene, please?
Yeah, please come.
So what I had in mind while asking this question was, you have also mentioned that while Indian laws are great, it is enforcement that is missing. Maybe because of bribery, maybe because of profit motive, or maybe anything else. I was wondering whether, for example, in Visakhapatnam, the LG Polymers case, the public living around that and prone to getting affected by any leakage, if by system, they are made a part of the safety inspection carried out by pollution control people at regular intervals, will that help? And will that help in ensuring all the safety laws are properly followed?
Okay, fine. Even if our regulatory bodies work fantastic, okay. Mm-hmm. But the change has to come from within us. Now take, for example, this lockdown in COVID. See, government was very strict, but yet you see thousands of people flouting the lockdown. So if you don't have it from within us, after all, government brought down this lockdown, brought in this lockdown to protect us. But in spite of, you can't have a policeman every inch covering every inch of the land. Even a place like Pune, I see people flouting, violating the lockdown norms. So same goes with any of these chemical industries, there are various aspects to it. One is the regulatory bodies. When second is the manufacturing unit itself, they should have the sense of responsibility towards the nation and the people. And third is the people themselves, we don't want to change. We only talk. And I'm being very curt and outright in this. And I gave you an example of this lockdown and COVID. You see thousands of people violating and, flouting these lockdown norms. Okay, next question.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. There's one final question left to be answered. Actually, that is not a question. It is a situation shared by someone to Hardik sir, which is with situation like COVID, there is a clear gap in the security and safety. Actually, recently, I think he traveled through air and noticed that severe security issues, including the content of luggage, was not properly screened. He's asking your views on
it. Okay, very good question. Whoever raised this question. You see, we have the security of the airports now. Now, I'll take your mind back to that famous Salisbury poisoning case. You know, what these people use is a small perfume bottle, you know, very small perfume bottle, spray type, you know, which contained this new chemical called the Novichok, which was used to contaminate the doorknob of the gentleman, this Russian spy called Sergei Skripal. Now, that fellow touched this doorknob, and in fact, they have infected most part of the area, contaminated with this spray. So, similar situation could occur in our airports. Now, I'm not very sure, but I'm very sure when it comes to most of the Western airports, what I've seen in the US or Western Europe in my wide travels all across, they have systems in place to even detect any harmful chemicals or also radiation sources. I'm not very sure if all the airports in India have the same system, of detecting. Though they allow 100 milliliters and below as this thing, but are they have the mechanisms? And unfortunately, I'm not able to answer you whether all the airports in India have to detect such chemicals being carried in small spray bottles, perfume spray bottles. And imagine somebody getting out, getting through the security. Now, there are many airports in India, especially I've seen one in Vijayawada, which doesn't have the CAS of people. They have the local policemen. And that fellow doesn't even bother to put the VIPs through the security screening. He just salutes them and shows them the way, please go from the other side. You don't need to go through security. If that type of attitude, things could happen. But the silver lining in this is whether the so-called militant terrorists are also that smart enough to design a device of that nature to cause any threat to us. But it could happen. There's a lot of information on the net one could share. And to make a spray perfume bottle is not a rocket science. There's a possibility.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. I think there are no more questions left to be answered. But I would definitely like to take a moment to thank you for this wonderful session. I mean, the audiences and I especially, we enjoyed a lot. I mean, these are the gems which we should know, but very delightful and very insightful, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. I would like to thank Ashwin and Hardik and Sanchita and Kritika for allowing me to speak here, and the great support with Sanchita and all came. And I would like to thank all the participants. And I see some of my friends and seniors who are also took their time off to listen and attend to this presentation. I'm grateful to you all. Thank you very much. I hope this presentation is of some use to most of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everyone. A quick session will be conducted every fortnight and is being broadcasted under SEBLO umbrella. And with this, we come to an end to our episode 2. And we really hope to host you again on the 6th of August. And I hope we see you on our next episode 2. Thank you so much and stay safe.